This, I declare the annual meeting adjourned. Next, I was going to give a annual report on what the society has been up to. During this program year, we provided 7 programs and 7 newsletters, September through November, the holiday break, and then February through May. In September, the History Day students were given awards, which has been done annually in recent years, and the society was awarded a Bedford Cultural Council grant for the February program, which was the visit with Abraham Lincoln. The society, we've had some progress on reestablishing the museum, which was originally in the Stearns Building, now Police Station, but it was closed when the police station needed that space. Consultant study was completed this year and recommended that the town use the old town hall for the museum, town museum. So at this point, negotiations are pending between the society's board of directors and the town in order to work out arrangements, which we hope will happen in the very near, not too distant near future. For our collections and displays, we talk about a lot of the collection things in our newsletters, but we have continued to expand the inventory of collections that's shown on our virtual museum site that's accessed from our website. And this year, we also worked with DPW, and we added links, which is actually on DPW site, to a bunch of antique maps, most of which we provided. And the old burying ground survey, which was done in the late 90s, John Brown, Bob Schlechta, Helen Nowers, James Guzzo, and others were involved in putting that together, where the old burying ground was finally mapped accurately. But DPW has put the entire survey report online, so you can find the gravestones by alphabetically by numbers and a lot of the other history that was provided by that group. This year, we also added the uniform of Minuteman Captain Steve Tutko. He was the Minuteman Captain during the National Bicentennial 1975, and so we have all of his captain's uniform. We've got on a mannequin in the office now, but it probably is going to be a very attractive piece for a Bedford Minuteman Company program that we'll have in the museum when it happens. There was another Rufus Porter mural that had been in the Jonas Monroe House. It's where Bedford Motel is now on North Road. The mural had been saved when the house was demolished and had been in the Spofford's barn for a few decades. They did donate it to the society, and this year we did get it moved over to Town Hall. It's now in the multipurpose room auditorium, and there's still a lot of work. It's an extremely heavy mural, but it's going to be permanently installed in the multipurpose room. Right now, if you go in there and you're sitting facing the stage, up on the left-hand side, there is a mural that was already recovered and is framed. It belongs to the society. And now this is going to be on the right-hand side. As you come into the stairs that come down into onto the floor from out in the hall. So that mural will be up and displayed in the very near future, we anticipate. After the high school had its renovations back a few years ago, there was a new lobby and a new display case in the lobby, and the society has been providing the displays. I finally got the town to put some electric outlets in so there's illumination. The cases are very deep, about 4 feet deep. No illumination. We had to have everything pressed up against the glass, and then you get a lot of reflection. So we now have proper displays, and the display there now is of Jonathan Bacon's work. He was an early entrepreneur back in the early 1800s. started the shoe industry here, and then he was an inventor, and we've got one of his original patents signed. In those days, the President of the United States signed patents, and this one is Andrew Jackson. But the original document is in the display. We also were just given on a long-term loan an antique Barlow grandfather clock. This is either late 1700s or early 1800s. It's a long-term loan from a Taylor family here in Concord. And Faye Russo and I made an executive decision, and when you go up to the top floor of Old Town Hall in the meeting room, you will see on the right-hand corner this clock. We decided that would be an attractive way to help dress up the great hall up there. So the clock works, still have to be installed, but Bill Moon and I got the case up there a week or two ago. Community outreach, Lane School, we continue to work with the 5 fifth graders. We have discovery kits. These are old, common household things that kids don't recognize now, and so they use these as the start of a discussion on local history. The Neshoba Learning Group is a school here in Bedford for developmentally challenged students, and we, for the last couple of years, been working with some of those, their high school age students, and in the office. They do, if going through scrapbooks, putting search terms in the computer. The one I'm working with now is doing the finding aid for all the books that the society has that have never been totally properly recorded, putting those on. Janet Collins, who's a volunteer, works there most afternoons, is working with them. The vital records for Bedford up to 1845 were published. From then on, the only place you'll find them is annual reports, and having to search through annual reports is tedious. So the student is working with Janet and putting all these on the computer so we can now do a much better search for this sort of thing. So we're helping the kids, and the kids are helping us. The Joe Blaine House, we keep working with the Friends, put in their display each summer. One of the open houses will be doing that again this year. Last year, they started a Colonial Kids summer program, a one-week summer program, and I'm involved doing a lot of antique tools with them, and so we'll be doing that again this summer. Bedford Day last fall, we had our flag in the parade, and we had a booth that was very popular. And some of you know Dean Rance is a blacksmith, and he was doing his blacksmithing there, and there's a lot of interest in people going by. On Memorial Day, we were rained out last year. This year, weather permitting, society gives short talks at the Shawsheen Cemetery observance, the Old Burying Ground observance, and at the World War I Memorial on the Common. We'll be doing that again. We also trying to keep working with the VA hospital, and this summer is their 90th anniversary here in Bedford. They're planning a big celebration, the picnic and other activities on Saturday, July 14th, and they hope to involve as many residents. They'd be delighted to have as many residents come to their celebration as possible. So they'll be getting more publicity out on that. And finally, we've been contacted by Middlesex Community College. They have a speaker series every summer, every fall, and they contacted us and will be participating in their speaker series this fall. So we're doing our best community outreach to work with a lot of other organizations. So that completes my report. Does anybody have any comments or questions? Okay, then we'll move on to our program. Our guest entertainment. Suzanne Powers and Larry Young are known as Musical Pastimes, and they're going to be performing a show that they call Revolution at the Birth of a Hopeful Nation. Ms. Powers and Mr. Young have found a perfect balance of music and interactive storytelling, filling gaps from our history books. Their performance will bring to life the human side of our history, and we invite audiences to make personal connections to the events that shaped our country. Musical Pastimes has performed at schools and libraries throughout New England and at other venues, including Concord Inn, Minuteman, National Historical Park, and numerous other historical societies. So with that, welcome, Musical Pastimes.
Don, will you give Suzanne your mic, please? Will you give Suzanne your...
I get you, I'm the microphone.
I don't think he has one.
No, I didn't get one.
He didn't get one. I'll just be right here. Mr. Tribolo.
I'm sorry.
Thank you.
The microphone is on the floor.
On the floor.
It's on the floor. Yeah, you have to kneel to be heard.
Oh, it's fine.
Do you want me up here or up there, Mr. Tribolo?
You? I want you just...
Just where I am.
Yeah, where you normally are.
Yeah, well...
Just be.
This is the first time I have been here. We're almost ready for you.
Yes, pretend we're not even here.
Yes.
Pretend that curtain is actually here.
Okay, I'm ready.
I'm ready. Ish.
Oh, I thought I'd beat you to it.
You did.
I did.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Tobias Tripp, and this vision of loveliness is none other than Prudence Merriweather, the finest violinist in all 13 colonies.
You want to speak over here?
I don't know. Should I?
I don't know. Can you hear us?
Can you hear us?
Okay, then we'll stay where we are. And we'll bring this closer. There
all
you
right.
go. All right.
All right. Hi. Yes. And we thought by way of introduction, we could sing a song of introduction. I thought that's what we could do.
Yes.
And because we can see just by looking at you that you are a singing crowd. Am I correct?
Yes.
Yes, indeed. That was a hearty yes. And so I thought we'd sing a song. It was a huge hit back in 1719. And it was published in London in a collection of music called Wit and Mirth, or Pills to Purge Melancholy. That was the name of this collection. I believe you can still buy those pills today as well. And it had over 1,000 songs in this collection. Can you believe it? It was 6 volumes long. And we're going to do one of them. And I shall teach you the chorus. It's very simple. It goes like this. Oh, well done, sir.
Well done.
It goes like this. How do you do? How do you do? How do you do again? That's all there is to it. Will you try that with me? How do you do? How do you do? How do you do again?
That was lovely.
Yes, it was indeed.
Yes.
A fabulous thing. And of course, that's how you said hello. In our day, you know, you didn't go to someone up on the street and say, "Yo, yo, Benji Frank, my man, what up?" You did not do that at all. No, you said, "How do you do?" That was the proper form of introduction, whether you were speaking to the governor of the colony or to someone who worked for you. And if you're a man, you would remove your hat and you would decide which of your 2 calf muscles was the more shapely.
Because
you wanted to show off your calf muscles, especially to the ladies, and you would put your best foot forward, hinging at the waist, and remove your hat and say, "How do you do?"
Is just that like your best foot right there?
I'm not sure. Yes. No. It's nothing much going on either foot. You know that. However, you could in those days, men who weren't well endowed in the calf department, they could actually go out and buy inserts that would go into their stockings to create the correct shape and form so as to impress the ladies.
Yes, impress the ladies.
And of course, if you were a lady, that was far too bold a maneuver. You know, you had to be much more demure, much more modest as a lady. So you would cast your eyes down and to the side. You wouldn't actually look directly into the face of the person you were addressing. And you'd make your curtsy. How do? You sink straight down, just like that, and come right back up again. And of course, it was straight down because ladies were wearing stays.
Oh, boy.
And for some reason or another, they'd come to a rather marked point just about here, and they were sometimes rather stiff. So if you bent over too far this way, you would actually impale yourself upon your own underwear. So it's straight down and straight up.
I think they've forgotten the song by now.
All right.
Let's get here back
we go.
To the song.
Yes. From Pills to Purge Melancholy. One misty, moisty morning, when cloudy was the weather, I met with an old man who was clothed all in leather. He was clothed all in leather, with a cap beneath his chin, singing, how do you do, how do you do, how do you do again. Well done, that's the chorus there. Chorus is the Greek word for you sing. I went a little farther, and there I met a maid. Going a milking? No, the milking's all, she said. I began to compliment, she began to sing, singing, how do you do, how do you do, how do you do again. She said her name was Dolly, clothed in a gown of grey. I, being somewhat jolly, persuaded her to stay. In many kind embraces, I stroked her double chin, singing, how do you do, how do you do, how do you do again. Said that we should married be, and she should be my bride. And long we should not tarry, and 20 things besides. I'd plow and sow and reap and mow while she could sit and spin, singing, how do you do, how do you do, how do you do again. Oh, Prudence Merriweather, in the most spectacular violinist in all 13 colonies, will you spin for us? Verses. Her parents soon consented, all parties were agreed. Her portion, 30 shillings, we married were with speed. And Will the Piper, he did play while others danced and sing, singing, how do you do, how do you do, how do you do, singing, how do you do, how do you do, how do you do again.
Well done. Thank you. Welcome to the 18th century. And I see you are such good singers. We invite you to spend the next hour with us in the 18th century. And in order to know, to really be authentic colonists, you need to know what it was like to go to a performance in the 18th century. Manners for the audience were slightly different than what you might be used to in your modern times. In those days, there were wooden benches in the front, and the middling class sat on wooden benches as close to the stage as possible. Those were the best seats in the house. You could see everything, you could hear everything, and you wanted to get your money's worth. On either side of the auditorium might have been an aisle, creating sections on either side of the performance hall, and that is where the elite would sit. The people of quality, that was the proper term in the 18th century. You good folks did not come to see the show. Oh no, you came to be seen and to show off your finery. Ladies, you might put on the dress with the ribbons from London and your new hat to show that your husband had a lot of money. In the back, where we see that we have lots of you, those were the rowdy folks. Those were the people, the soldiers, the servants, the people that did not sit quietly and clap. Oh no, you let everybody else know whether you liked something or you did not like something. So you need to overcome your good manners tonight and behave proper and colonial. And we know from records in Williamsburg, actually, that you came prepared just in case you carried rotten vegetables in your baskets, and those were thrown at the performers on stage. I point at you for no reason. And you would throw them on stage to make the performers stop. So we thought, what a fun idea. They're having a potluck. They are all armed for the evening. We should introduce this tradition. But no, of course, that would make the cleanup much too labor intensive. So Mr. Tripp had a good idea.
Yes, I did.
We're lending you our performance vegetables. And you may try out what it feels like to throw something at a performer. And that is not easily done, but go for it. Have fun. Mr. Tripp, go around.
I'm just gathering them up now. I'm just turning the
tables.
Yes, exactly. There you go.
Shall I start in the back?
Yes, start in the back where the rowdy folks are sitting, the skeptical ones. So what was on stage? Shakespeare was on stage. The children in the colonies learned Shakespeare because the children in London learned Shakespeare. And the colonists wanted to get for their own children the same education that the children in the old world received. So theater troupes would go from town to town performing Shakespearean plays. Variety shows were popular where you might have a little bit of flute playing and a little bit of dancing and a little bit of joke telling, a little bit of everything. And of course, music in the colonies was very popular. You had music in taverns. And you had music the next morning in church where you had hymn singing. And you had music in the parlor where your children would learn the harpsichord or the harp if you had enough money to afford lessons for your children. You always hoped that they would marry up into a higher level of society. And then you had music at dances. Music and dances were very, very popular. We are fortunate tonight to have Mr. Tripp here, who is an authentic 18th century Shakespeare interpreter. Is that right?
And you say.
You will put us in the mood of how Shakespeare might have sounded like in the 18th century. Is that drink part of you?
No, I haven't started yet.
You haven't started.
Wait, I'm getting into character now.
Okay. We shouldn't have armed them before you did that, I guess. I'm sorry.
It's all right. It's too late now.
Go ahead. Give us a little bit of Shakespeare.
Yes. All right, here we go. I'll do something from one of the tragedies.
Yes.
Tomorrow and tomorrow and
tomorrow.
Just creep in this petty bass from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time and all our yesterday have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out! Out!
Out!
Leaf candle! Life is but a walking shadow, a poor bear who struts and frets his hour upon the stage.
Earlier than and usual.
I'm working here. And then a scene. Sorry. Enough. All right.
I think that is
I was just getting the good bits. All right.
I'm sorry.
You're quite all right.
When the garlic flies, you know, that's the sign. All right, so that was Shakespeare. Shakespeare, the 18th century. Thank you, Mr. Tripp. Music. We were talking about music, yes. In 1729, here in Boston, somebody came up with the idea of putting a concert on stage. That had never been done before. So you buy tickets, you charge a price, and then you hear serious music on stage. That was revolutionary, and we are going to play for you a piece you might have heard. Here in Boston, it is by Georg Friedrich Händel, who was a German composer who emigrated to London and became a superstar. Here is the Minuet in G.
And curious thing about this particular piece is that I am going to play my bit, and Prudence is going to play what I just played. Yes, your bit is actually my bit, one measure late.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
That's right. So she's going to be chasing me all the way through the piece, playing what I just played. And it's so ingeniously constructed. that if I do my part correctly, it will make a beautiful harmony.
Let's see if you can pick it out that we're just a measure apart. All right. Let's see if you can do your bit correctly.
Yes, I know. could be my lucky night. Did Prudence mention dancers?
Yes.
And of course, dancing here, even in in Puritan colonial Massachusetts, was a huge. It was the major social pastime. By 1700, Cotton Mather is in Boston, famous Cotton Mather, and he's complaining that too many parents are spending money. Are sending their children off to dance lessons when they should be spending it on other more godly things. But point of fact, it was madly popular by 1700, and anyone who was anyone would learn to the latest steps from London and Paris. And you wanted to, in those days, of course, I'm sure it's all changed now, but in those days, you know, you wanted to look like you were wealthier than you actually were.
And one way
you could do this without, of course, actually having money was to have proper poise and carriage, just the sort of things that you would have learned at these dance masters.
Am I doing it right?
No.
Oh. No slouching.
That's right, no slouching.
No slouching.
These dances were called assemblies. There were major social events in Boston and out here in the countryside as well. And some of these major, these large assemblies, they'd have several large ones every year. And it was the go-to thing to do. It was the place to be socially. And you would go and you would meet old friends and you would gossip and you would make business deals and you would marry your friends, you know, your kids off as if you could. Always trying to marry up.
Marry up.
Marry up.
That's right.
And all sorts of things. Major events. Sometimes they'd start in sundown and they go all night long. All the way through till the next morning.
Like what we're doing tonight.
I take your meaning. All right. Okay. So now we're going to play a couple of tunes that you would have heard in these 18th century Massachusetts assemblies.
<I'm hot. laughs>
Tightening my bow.
See what I have to put up with for hundreds of years now.
Goodness gracious.
Oh, dear. Oh, yes, but this is fun. Thank you for reminding
me.
Since you are such good singers, and you've proven to us that you are true colonists, it follows that you would have gone to school here in the colonies. Mr. Tripp and I would like to play this little game with you where we see if you studied hard and if you had strict parents and how much of your Shakespeare you remember. So, Mr. Tripp and I, we are going to start Shakespearean quotes. And you shall finish them for us. Yes, you just shout out the word or two that's missing at the end, and then you get nothing.
Nothing, sorry.
Yes, but before you get nervous, we'll warm you up with the easiest one there is. To be or not to be? Ooh, that is a very good audience.
That is the answer.
That is the answer. And the question.
All right, my turn.
Very good, yes.
Friends, Romans, countrymen. It's just so.
We have to make it more difficult.
Go on, then.
A rose by any other name would...
Smell as sweet.
Sweet is what I'm looking for. Very nice.
Something is rotten in the state of...
They know it all.
They do.
They do.
They do.
Try harder.
Go on. Give them a tricky one.
Ha! If music be the food of love...
Yes.
Oh, thank you. You know my favorite book. Play on is the answer. Very nice.
A horse. A horse.
My kingdom.
Too easy.
There is a method to my madness. Very good.
Double, double, toil and trouble, fire burn and...
I think they all read Harry Potter. That's in Harry Potter, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so.
Uneasy lies the head that wears...
the crown.
Now, this next one, I myself didn't get. Let's see if anybody here has got this one. How sharper than a serpent's tooth it is.
To have a thankless child.
Thank you.
Oh, she has very
good.
Very nice.
My father used to say that to me.
I was just going to say, you're either an English teacher or you've raised teenagers yourself. Very good. And all is well that ends well. You are the smartest audience we've had in a long time, Mr. Tripp. Yeah, we need to up our game.
I know.
Well done.
Get something more obscure.
Well done.
Well, we said we'd talk a bit about, 18th century.
Are you struggling much there?
I got it, look.
Yeah, oh, you did.
I got it on the third try. Yes, and you know, you cannot speak of 18th century Massachusetts without at least passing reference to a certain party that took place in Boston in December of 1773. I'm referring, of course, to
the Boston Tea Party.
Yes, of course, in our day, it was not known as the Tea Party at all. It was known as the Destruction of the Tea. A handful of Massachusetts colonists went on board three vessels that did not belong to them, threw overboard in what today's money would be over $1 million worth of property. Vandalization of over $1 million worth of property.
He's still mad about it.
Can you tell?
Look, yes.
Look at me. Look at me.
William was from Bedford. Thompson Maxwell.
There you are. There we are. We've come to the scene of the crime.
Aha!
And of course, this infuriates Parliament and King George III. And what do you suppose he did?
He tweeted about it.
Yes.
No, he didn't. No. What he did is he closed down the port of Boston. Quiet. This is my bit. To close down the port of Boston puts a stranglehold on the economy because Boston's almost all of their source of wealth came from the sea, whether it was from shipbuilding or trading or fishing or what have you. Closes down the port, and this puts a stranglehold on the economy, and in very short order, as you well know, leads to armed conflict. So Prudence and I, That's you.
That's me.
Thought we would sing a very old song about this destruction of the tea. But in it, you must use your imaginations. For I shall play the part of Old Mother England.
Very old mother.
And Prudence here is going to play the part of my rebellious young colonies.
We could have stressed the young a little.
No, rebellious gets stressed. Here we go. There was a rich lady lived over the sea, and she was an island queen. Her daughter lived off in a far country with an ocean of water between. With an ocean of water between. Now the old lady's pockets were filled with gold.
No, they were not.
Yeah, no, they were filled with gold. Look. Not just one, they filled it both sides. But never contented was she.
You have no money.
She ordered her daughter to pay her a tax of threepence a pound on the tea. The tea of threepence a pound on the tea.
Oh, mother, dear mother, the daughter replied, I'll not do the thing that you ask. I'm willing to pay a fair price for the tea, but never the threepenny tax. But never the threepenny tax.
Oh, you shall, cried the mother, and reddened with rage, for you're my own daughter, you see. And 'tis only fitting the daughter should pay her mother a tax on the tea. The tea, her mother a tax on the tea. So the tea was conveyed to her daughter's own door, all down by the ocean side. But the bouncing girl poured out every ounce on the dark and the roiling tide, the tide on the dark and the roiling tide.
And then she called out to the island queen, oh mother, dear mother, called she, your tea you may have went to steeped quite enough, but never a tax from me,
but never a tax from me.
Thank you.
You're very kind.
Thank you very much. I like this bit here, rather.
I know.
It's
that's
a good bit, yeah.
It's quite the special effect.
Yes, it is nice.
Yes.
Special effects have come a long way since those days.
I know. Yes, yeah. And this, I don't know what this is. It's a piece of trash.
Okay. No, the tea fell out. The tea fell out, yes.
What are we doing next?
Well,
Prudence Merriweather.
Do you want to talk a little bit about Off She Goes?
Oh, would I ever?
Would you ever?
Yes, so
that's my favorite song.
Yes, indeed. All right, we're going to play an old fiddle tune with the curious title of Off She Goes. Perhaps you know it. It's still played at contra dances today. But in our day, it was actually found at sea, believe it or not. You know, in the day of sail, everything was done by muscle power on board ship. There are no engines and such, so on. And so so the crew would work together. And one way to get them to all pull together and work together was to have them sing sea shanties. Now, in the British, in the Royal Navy, singing wasn't allowed. It was thought to be too good for morale. So instead, what they'd do is they'd have a fiddle player or a fifer play a melody to get to keep all the sailors working in unison. And so when it came time to raise up the anchor, which on a large vessel could weigh, you know, as much as a Toyota, and they would use this vertical winch called a capstan. And the capstan was fitted with bars that would go into the holes at the top, and they're called pigeonholes. And then the crew would walk round it, pushing. And of course, it's called heaving, actually. Heaving on board ship is pushing. It's not that big. So they go round and round, heaving away at these capstan bars to the tune of Off She Goes. That was an introduction far longer than the actual tune.
There was a fiddler sitting on top of the
Sometimes there was a fiddler.
Yeah.
Or a
Did
fiddler.
You mention that? I zoned out.
No, that's all right. No, I forgot. No, well done. I forgot to mention that's where they put it. They put the instrumentalist right on top of the capstan. So, you know, it was easy enough when things were going slow. But when it sped up, he'd be spinning round and round. Just like you're going to be when you play this. Come on, you can do it. Here we go. Off she goes.
And you have to decide by yelling yes or no if the following inventions are American and 18th century. Only then does it get a yes. Let's see how smart you really are. Aha! I'll start with an easy one. The bifocals. I happen to wear them today.
Yes.
The bifocals. Yes. Very good. Very nicely done. Benjamin Franklin. Yes. Of course, invented in the 18th century. Yes. Truly American. How about the cotton gin?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. That was 19th century.
1793. Oh, it just eked into the 18th century there. Eli Whitney, very good. That gets another yes. Very good. How about the parachute? That was Leonardo da Vinci, yes. Well, you know, I thought after dinner you might fall asleep a little. I'm just trying to see who's still awake. Very nice. How about the left and right shoe? Clever idea.
Who knows? Yeah, move on.
That's right. No. This is fascinating history, Mr. Turner.
Go on, then.
You know how shoes, before this time, this is actually, I will give it away, it is American and 18th century, and it was invented by John Adam Daguerre. He was called the father of American shoemaking. He had the idea, instead of just making one shape, which would then be, because the leather was supple, the heat of your foot would mold it into the shape of your foot, much like slippers, right, that we always wear on the same foot. He came up with the idea of making a left and a right shoe. I think probably because if you lose one, you have to buy a whole new pair and not just one more shoe. Seems like very American entrepreneurism right there. So that is a yes, very good. How about the steam engine?
No.
Fulton.
Yeah.
1765. But it was invented by James Watt, and he was Scottish. It was invented in Edinburgh, so we can't have it. Can't have it. Moving on. How about the printing press?
No.
Right. Germany, Gutenberg. I know. Yes, okay. They are smart.
They are.
They truly are. The mariner's compass. So very important for seafaring.
somewhere.
Stay with 12th hundred. The Chinese invented it in the 12th century. Very good. You, sir, are being disqualified from knowing every answer. Every answer. Let the other kids have a tongue. Okay. Aha! The submarine. The submarine.
American Civil War.
David.
Erickson.
David Bushnell. And not the Civil War, the Revolutionary War. It was called the Turtle, and it was basically a big barrel, and it was hand cramped. One of those hand cramped. What are you doing behind me?
I'm just setting up for later.
What are we doing?
Carry on.
Okay. I thought you were going to put me in a submarine or something. Hand crank barrel situation that was weighted down with big weights. And it was actually used in the war. So in New York Harbor, was it? New York Harbor. The Turtle, it was called, was put underwater. And it was hand cranked all the way over to Britain's man of war, HMS Eagle. The Eagle. And the mission was to drill holes in the hull of the man of war, attach explosives or something, then hand crank your way really quickly away, and then the whole thing blows up. Well, it didn't turn out this way. Unfortunately, the rudder of the HMS Beagle got entangled with the weights that kept the Turtle underwater, and up she bobs before the hole was drilled. So it was a failed mission, but it was a submersible in wartime, and that counts, totally counts as a submarine in the 18th century. Very nicely done. Surgical anesthesia. Mass General 1842. If you consider how recent that is, I shudder at the thought of it. Of course, the elite was using ether in the 18th century already at parties. You see, they would just sniff it and get high on it. And that is where the expression, we had a gas, comes from. Do you ever still say that or hear it? We had a gas. It's a little outdated, but that's where it's from. The elite used it at parties, had no idea about side effects or dosage, right? And that's why I say surgical anesthesia, because I believe in 1842, the patient actually woke up again at Mass General. Very good. And the last one, my last trivia question here is root beer. This very American drink, or is it? Root beer. Well, it was invented in 1767, the English invented carbonation. So we kind of have to ride their coattails a little on the carbonation, because you can't have flat root beer. But it was the American pharmacists that either saw it from the Native Americans, that they put something in their water, or they tinkered around on their own, but they realized if you add roots and leaves, you can sell it for more money. And you can claim medicinal benefits. And that's exactly what they did. And there, here was this carbonated water with sugar and something else, and they called it root beer. And there you have an 18th century American invention.
Well done.
Very good. Well done. Should we do some music
Let's
now?
Let's do some music.
Thank you.
What are you in the mood for?
Maggie Lauder.
All right.
Maggie Lauder, I will play for you the most difficult piece.
Well, we have Prudence Merriweather, the finest violinist in the galaxy.
Oh, thank you.
And she's here tonight. So
in all 13 colonies.
Yeah, that too.
That's the fourth swing.
Yes, she's got rattled.
It's the television cameras.
Is it?
What is that instrument?
This is the cittern, C-I-T-T-E-R-N. And I did some research. This was the most commonly found instrument in colonial Massachusetts in the 17th century and the beginning of the 18th century.
I've never heard that.
Yeah, the cittern. And it was brought by the Puritans, believe it or not. You know, everyone thinks the Puritans didn't have any music, but they did.
Guitar.
They did indeed. And, of course, back in the old world, the cittern was found hanging on the wall in barbershops and bordellos. Ooh. Yeah. So if you were just a gentleman waiting for his turn, as it were, you would take it off the wall and practice a little bit.
Well, on the air, Mr. Tripp.
So, you know, in those days, if you told your wife you were going off to practice the cittern, you'd better come home with a very close shave. That's all I can say. So, one thing.
Yes.
The whole bit was very close shave. Let's see. Yes, Maggie Lauder. So we've got Prudence here, and we're going to use, you know, one of the most common compositional techniques of the 18th century is called theme and variations.
Yes.
And that was where a composer would take a melody, sometimes even a simple folk melody, and state it, and then repeat it over and over again, making each iteration, you know, each repetition more and more devilishly difficult to play. So Prudence here is going to play theme and variations on an old Scots tune called Maggie Lauder.
Are you ready?
I am ready. Yes, indeed. And what has she got, ladies and gentlemen? A fan, of course. Indispensable fashion accessory for every 18th century lady of quality.
Yes, a fan.
A fan. You know, it was said that even the very plainest of ladies could look beautiful with the proper use of her fan. Which, of course, is hardly necessary tonight. I point out, rather too hastily. You know, some of these fans were made of very expensive materials.
Not this one.
Not that one, no. They may be made of ivory or lace. Some were even studded with jewels. Can you believe that? But in addition to being a beautiful object and a useful object in a crowded assembly hall, supposedly, in the 18th century, there was a secret language of the fan, by which a woman could communicate non-verbally across a crowded room with her lover. Did you know this?
Texting.
Had you heard this before?
Yeah. It's so, like texting. You guys text, I wave.
You wave. For example, if the lady touched her right cheek with the fan, that meant yes. If she touched her left cheek with the fan, that meant no. If she twirled the fan slowly in her right hand, that meant we are being watched.
Which is so true.
The moment it's true. If she twirled the fan slowly in her left hand, that was bad news, gentlemen. That meant I love another.
Oh. Uh-oh.
No, not you, another.
Oh.
Yes.
All right.
If she fanned herself slowly, that meant I am married.
Oh, yeah.
If she fanned herself quickly, that meant I am engaged to be married.
So much more exciting.
Yes, ignorance is bliss. Open and shut.
Oh.
Open and shut meant.
Oh, that's going to be fun. Yes.
Yes.
What does this mean?
That meant you, sir, are cruel.
Yes.
You are cruel,
sir. You're flirting with somebody else. That's what it is.
Open wide meant wait for me.
Mm.
And supposedly, the number of panels that she left exposed was the hour of your tryst. It was the hour of your meeting, you know. So you had to count your panels very carefully, gentlemen. You might end up at the right place at the wrong time. Let's see. Oh, held with the handle to the lip.
Oh,
that's rather self-evident, really. That's kiss me. Yes.
Selfie face.
Yes, the selfie face. Held in the right hand in front of the face meant follow me.
Wait, am I doing this right?
No. That's follow me into a post.
Oh.
Yeah. Follow me.
Okay.
That's right. Drawing across either cheek meant I love you.
Let's take a look.
Oh, I love you.
Oh,
however,
very coquette.
If the lady placed the fan upon her left ear, that meant I wish to get rid of you. And if she actually took the fan and tossed it ever so gently the gentleman's back while avoiding the microphone on the floor, it meant let's do something else. Time is passing. There we go. All right, let's do something else.
Well, I think it's time, Ms. Martin.
Yes.
Do we have time for parlor games?
I don't know. How much time have we got left, Carol?
Shush. We have time. We have time for parlor games because nothing is funner than playing parlor games after dinner. And I'll say it again, nothing is funner than playing parlor games after dinner. So, Mr. Church, you see, in the 18th century, sometimes people think we go to bed as soon as the sun sets because candles are expensive, and then we get up at first light. No, it's not true. We love staying up late just like you guys do. But of course, we don't have anything to, you know, do pictures to take of our dinners and post it on Facebook or whatever people do. We play parlor games. When we have special company, like Mr. Chip and I, we have you tonight. So cards were popular to play, dice were popular, but with a nice crowd, we would play parlor games. So Mr. Chip and I, we thought, how fun. We'll go to Bedford and we'll bring authentic 18th century parlor games to the good people of the Historical Society. So we had to do a little bit of research to find out which parlor games were really popular in the 18th century, and we find out, we go on a thing called Google, which is the work of the devil. I don't know that one really, right? Thank you. And we find out that Blind Man's Bluff was the most played, most popular game of the 18th century. You all know how it goes. One person gets blindfolded, goes around the room, touching everybody, that's the funny part, trying to figure out who is who. Well, we thought that might not be such a good idea tonight to blindfold you and send you off down the hallways. We'll probably never find you again. So you'll have to play it after we leave amongst yourselves. But we did find a game we can play with you, and it's called Tableau Vivant. Did you hear my French?
It's magnifique, ça, alors.
It means living pictures. And what we're going to do, Mr. Tripp and I, we are going to act out famous paintings. And you have to guess which painting we are. And so, again, we do research on this Google thing. And it turns out another thing that was very popular in the 18th century was nudity, which I think is a Historical Society no-no. Is that true? So
probably.
We had to pick paintings that are family-friendly, but they are not actually all from the 18th century. So that's my little disclaimer.
There we are.
And just shout out if you think you have any idea what Mr. Tripp is doing.
All right. So the first one is, so if you think you know the name of the painting, Just shout it out.
Shout it out.
Here we go. Number one is my solo.
It is?
Yes, so you must scurry off my canvas. You're too close.
How big is your canvas?
I don't know. Oh. Number one, here we go.
Scream.
Good.
Go on.
Very good. Very good.
Number two.
Okay.
I need you for this one, actually.
Oh, now you want me.
Yeah, now I need you.
Now you
know. Number two.
Okay.
American Valor.
Very good. Very good. I think it was the apron.
Yeah, very good.
Yeah, it was, yeah.
Number three is your solo,
my excellent acting, it was.
And,
yes. Yes. This way is good.
You're going to do it yourself?
I'm going to do it myself.
Off. I'm going to scurry off.
Modern woman and all.
Number three.
Whistler's mother.
Whistler's mother.
Very nice.
Right.
Very good. I think the cap makes it easier than usual. Yes,
yeah, right.
But very clever.
Number four.
We have another one.
Yes, number four.
Okay.
You must assume the position.
Assume the position.
And I need my hat, my chapeau.
Can I use the microphone?
No, number four.
Okay.
Washington.
Yes.
That's right. Very good. Very good.
You're not allowed to move in a painting.
Oh, yes.
Number four. Good.
Moving pictures come later.
Yes.
Very good.
Oh, number five.
Number five.
Number five.
Which sadly is actually, is that our last one? That's our last one. So put everything you have into this performance.
I will do my very best. Number five.
Okay. Sorry. Yes, we should do this on stage.
That's right. Number five.
That's right. And who am I?
God.
Yes, thank you. I am God. Did you hear that?
I finally heard, yes.
Okay.
You'd love to hear that every
week. There's some nudity. Give me the other leg. Okay. All right. Very good.
You know.
Very good. Thank you.
They would amuse themselves for minutes at a time with this
game. Well, yes.
And look what time it's become.
It's
time for our final number, I believe.
If you are allowed to do more 18th century paintings, it would be maybe... Never mind.
Right. Well, we're going to end up with one of our favorite 18th century pieces.
Yes.
And we've got this magnificent violinist here. So let's put her to work one more time.
Yes.
And we'll play something. This is by an Italian composer by the name of Luigi Boccherini, who spent most of his adult life in Spain. And you may have heard this piece before. Has anyone here seen a film called Master and Commander? Yeah. Russell Crowe. Do you remember that film? Fabulous film. In it, he plays a British naval captain, frigate captain. It's early 19th century, but during the Napoleonic Wars. And he's an amateur violinist, and his surgeon on board ship is an amateur cellist. And the very end of the film, they're dashing away on this lovely piece in this cabin as the ship turns around and heads off into the sunset to pursue the enemy. So, of course, in the film, the credits roll up, as this part. So just imagine the credits are rolling up as we play this for you now. Here we go. I think I start. Are we ready?
Yeah, I am. I'm aging right next to you.
Thank you. so much, Carol, for having us.
Yes, thank you, Carol. Thank you. Welcome. Ah, yes.
Oh, yes. If you could.
Last chance.
Hand to the women.
Thank you. Now it feels like the 1870s.
There you go. Thank you.
What's that? Where's the cabbage? Who has the cabbage? I'm missing this thing. Was it flung?
It's flung already. It went
well,
to my side.
Oh, here. You deserve it. Thank you.
Thank you very much.